Okay.
Start us off with the intro?
Yeah.
Roll the intro?
Yeah.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Good everyone. Just a quick little introduction on both of us before we start.
Yeah.
You want to start us off?
Yeah, all good. My name is Francis Ledger. 34 years old. 34 years old. Born in Australia. Grew up till I was about last year of primary, and then moved home with my mum, and been in New Zealand throughout all my schooling years. And went to Grayland Primary first of all, and then Waikowhai Intermediate. Went to Mount Albert Grammar when I was third and fourth form, before moving to St. Paul's College. Currently academy lead for Waitakere Rugby League Academy, and yeah, got a wife and three kids. Enjoying life, yeah.
Good everyone. My name is Brody Tamaro, 23 years old. Born and raised in Kaitaia, the Hearty North. I'm actually the second oldest of eight. There's eight of us between my mum and my old man. I have two kids, Kiwa and Sailor. What else is there? Went to school, did all my schooling years up north, born and raised up there. Went to Pukipuro Primary, then from there went to Kara Intermediate and to the best college in New Zealand, Kara College.
Kara.
Kara. But that's a bit about me and our intros, I guess. But this is the Breaking Bread podcast.
Yeah, Breaking Bread.
With me and Francis. But on the Breaking Bread podcast, did you want to give us a rundown on the name and I guess why we started this?
Yeah, obviously, Breaking Bread podcast got the idea actually from the movie Breaking Bad. those of you that haven't seen Breaking Bad, it's a little series, but Breaking Bread I thought was a good name. Shout out to Charles for the name, and we basically went over it, just talking about breaking bread with people, fellowshipping with one another, also just being able to just sit and chat as you do in a podcast. So we came up with the name Breaking Bread, plus bread meaning money, money meaning business, also bread meaning food.
Yep.
You obviously know what we want to get into and all of that in the food side of things. So I thought that Breaking Bread just fitted nicely with what we had spoke about and what we were wanting to do. That's basically how the name Breaking Bread came along.
Yeah, I guess when me and Seth started this, for a few days we're like, fuck, we need a name.
That's the hard thing.
Yeah.
That's something that's going to be there forever.
Yeah, hard. And when he come up with the idea of Breaking Bread, it was, I guess we both liked it and we rolled with it too. That's our name, Breaking Bread. And
Well, do you, we'll get into a little bit about talking about why we're starting one. You want to give a little insight to like what we spoke about before at Shisha?
Yeah.
What your thoughts on that were, and then I'll add on to that.
Yeah, for me, I've been wanting to do one for a few years, but as you do, you sort of put it to the side and then never really do it, and it's always something in your head that you just want to do. But I've been wanting to do one, I guess, just to hear people's stories and listen to other people's stories and connecting with them. But I've always liked listening to podcasts. I listen to Ice's podcast, and really enjoy his ones. And yeah, I thought I could probably do this one day because I like to talk shit. So yeah, and then I'd been thinking about it, and then there was a time where I was just thinking when I'd come back home, and then I was like, fuck, thinking about you, like, fuck, I'll hit him up and see if he'd want to do one. And then I remember we're at Shisha, and I was like, ooh, you know what we should do? And what's that? And I was like, we should start a podcast. And fuck, I'm meant to start one last week, and I was like, fuck, we should do one. And I'm like, yeah. So yeah, I guess it's been in the running for a few weeks now, planning this. So, yeah, do you want to give us your rundown on it?
Nah, exactly right. I guess for me, like, podcast is the new way to go with things.
Mm.
Obviously, just chuck it on and go about your business and have it in the background or while you're driving. So, nah, I've always wanted to get into this space. I actually like being on podcasts and being asked. So, when... I think I done my first one a while ago. I was just like, man, this is something that I could do.
Yeah.
It's a good way to, again, communicate with others, but also meet and listen to other people's stories.
Mm.
So just with a lot of people that I guess we both know and also that I know, like growing up, I know there's a lot of untold stories out there.
Yeah.
Especially to like our everyday people. Obviously, there's stories about people that make it from like your neighborhood and your area or school or whatever. But there's a lot of successful people that you know that you might not have heard of that are doing very well for themselves. So
yeah.
I think for me, my drive and my passion to starting the podcast was getting those stories out.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, we know a lot of people that have businesses that are doing well, but not only that, I guess also people that do well for their community.
Yeah.
So, yeah, hence the reason why I like the idea of doing a podcast. And obviously we can tell those stories, they can tell their own stories, and obviously we can shed light on them. So, yeah, that was the reason why I've always wanted to start a podcast. But, yeah, like we spoke about at Shisha, like... It's a funny story because I was meant to start a podcast at the beginning of the year and I had done all this planning. I had done put everything into place. I even had all the equipment and everything, but I just kept using the excuse of I had no camera.
Yeah. We should see our cameras now. Still no camera.
Still no camera, just two iPads sitting on the chair. So I guess, you know, I think that was fate. I think that was God's plan, I guess, just for us to connect. It was quite funny when you had said, gee, we should start a podcast. So I think that was my my nudge that I needed to get this off the ground. So, yeah, so here we are. Obviously, as basic as they come, in a lounge room with two iPads and I think some pretty cool gear.
Yeah, hard. Got to start somewhere.
Hard out. So, yeah. What
but nah, yeah. Well, so we'll get into it. We'll go into a bit more detail about myself and Sis. Obviously, when we talk to other people, you know, we'll open up to them. So I think, as you said, you know, earlier, I think it's important for us to open up about ourselves before, you know, we
ask others.
Yeah, hard. But yeah, first childhood,
yeah.
Just on that, obviously we probably would have had both different upbringings. You're born in Aussie and grew up in Auckland in the city, and I'm from up north where she's all farm and beaches. So
yeah,
you want to give us a insight on yours?
My upbringing is is far from the city.
Yeah.
Being born in Australia, a little town in Queensland called Tully. If you don't know where Tully is, either Google it or because if you blink you'll miss it. But it's in between Cairns and Townsville, up in the far north Queensland there. But yeah, growing up in Tully was, man, I was blessed. Honestly, like, we had our family houses. There was three family houses right next door to each other. So our backyards all connected. Tully being a small place, everyone knew everyone. So basically, I grew up with my cousins, and we just basically played outside all day, every day, whether we were going down to the creek, whether we were going like back to school and playing on the field at the playground, or just playing in the backyard. So I think for me, I'm pretty grateful that I had the upbringing that I did when I was younger, being surrounded by family all the time. And if there was no food at my house, I'd go downstairs. Or if there's no food downstairs, like, we'd all go next door to my auntie and uncles. And if there's no food there, then we'll go to the house next door to that. So I think for us, like, growing up with family was massive for me, and hence the reason why I love like a busy, loud house.
Yeah,
it just reminds me of my childhood, and I like family just rocking up anytime.
Yeah,
that's basically how we grew up.
Yeah.
But and then it's sort of like, how can I explain it? Like, the scenery changed when I moved back to Auckland.
Yeah.
Obviously, Auckland being in the city.
Yeah.
I was fortunate enough again to grow up with the other side of my family, around Greyland, and a little bit up in Ponsonby there. So, like, I was always with my two cousins, Biles and Giles, Marlo and Tully, for those that don't know. Our upbringing from then on was fun. Like, we'd done everything together, us three, and we had all our cousins, and even our friends that came over, people thought they were our cousins because they ended up living with us and whatnot. And then, obviously, got an introduction to having an older brother, Ards, come along. So, man, I honestly would love to go back to my childhood when I was a young kid and relive exactly what I went through and how we were brought up in Australia and in New Zealand, because I think that's what made me who I am today, and like, made me just love being around, like, family and friends.
Yeah.
What about yourself?
Yeah. Oh, I grew up in Kaitaia.
What do you guys say, Kaitaia?
Kara. I don't know. It just rolls off the tongue, I think. I think it's Kaitaia. Meals on Wheels. In Maui.
Oh, yeah, true.
Meals on Wheels. So I grew up, born and raised up there. Did all my schooling up there. But like you said, the old saying, takes a village to raise a child, and that was definitely me. I had my mum, single mum growing up. And I was mostly raised by my grandparents, my nan and my papa, and had a lot of aunties and uncles who helped raise me too. So pretty lucky there. Yeah, went to Pukeporta Primary, did all my primary there, got intermediate and Kaitaia College. But pretty grateful for my family, as you said. Growing up, those are the best memories of your cousins and your mates, and it's fun growing up in Kaitaia, you know, because this is when you're young, it's a bit different to the city, you know. You get to roll around the city, and whereas up Kaitaia, you probably takes you around an hour to walk around the whole town. But it was fun. Obviously had some hardship with the like growing up with not having everything, but we always had a roof over our head and food on the table, no matter where we were. I know my mum struggled a bit during her time with us kids, and you can't beat growing up north, I think. And you know, you always got the beach there. You know, there were some days where me and my mates would want to go to the beach, so we'd hitch out to the beach.
How far is the beach from where you are?
So we used to go to Ahipara, which is about probably 10-15 minute drive.
Oh yeah.
But we used to hitch out there, or
Shipwreck.
Yeah, Shipwreck Bay. But but it wasn't until one of our mates got, you know, when your mate gets their car for your first one, and you go rolling around it to all the beaches. That's just the old who's chipping in for gas.
You know, it's funny when you talk about, like, as soon as someone gets a car, like, walking down the road becomes fiery.
Yeah, hard.
You want to jump in the car and go anywhere and everywhere. And sometimes, like, just down the road, like, before you would easily walk, now you know you got a car. But everyone's piling in and everyone.
Yeah, hard.
Yeah, talking about the gas and whatnot. So.
But yeah, nah, childhood was, it's mean, like growing up there, like we didn't have it all or didn't have much. Like we weren't a rich family, but seeing, I guess, you see your mates and cousins and other family, they struggle more. So it sort of makes you, made me grateful for what I had and didn't take things for granted. Yeah. So yeah, grateful for my mum and my nan and my papa and all my other aunties, uncles and my old man there too. So yeah.
Yeah, shout out to all the grandparents and aunties, uncles that, or even older cousins that help out and chip into your upbringing, because I was the same. Like, I was fortunate enough to be brought up by both my grandparents on both sides. Mm. So I was very close with my dad's parents, who unfortunately have passed away, and I was very blessed to be brought up by my mum's parents as well, which I still have my nana, who's here, and my grandfather who passed away end of last year. So man, shout out to all those families, friends, everyone who chips into to help raise not only myself, but you know, all everyone else who's been blessed to be raised by more than just their parents, man.
So, yeah,
pretty buzzy upbringing as well. It's pretty similar, I guess.
Small town.
Yeah. But then, you know, you come to the city, and then that's when I think things get things start changing.
Yeah, get a bit more faster.
Yeah, get a bit more faster, and then get a bit more lazier, I reckon. Yeah. And then start relying on a lot more things. Rather than just yourself, but like how you would be in a small town. So, it's been all good. What about how we met, our footy journeys?
Yeah. Oh yeah, but our footy journey. So yeah,
we move on to footy journeys, or
yeah, hard.
Add on to childhood and.
No, we'll go footy journeys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Well, where did you first start? Your footy journey.
Well, yeah, obviously through playing rugby league is how we met, and but yeah, my footy journey. So I grew up playing. So up north, it's mostly rugby. League's very isolated from pretty much Whangarei upwards. So grew up playing rugby, and then there was just one time there was a bit of league on down at the field. So my uncle, my papa actually took me down to. Took me down to the fields with to play with one of his good mates, Jim Larkin, who I'm grateful for. He's a man who taught me pretty much everything I know about rugby league. He's as we got older, me, him, and his two sons, my two cousins, we all grew up playing, and you know, he took us all over the country to play. So very grateful for him and what he's done for me. I know he's helped a lot of other boys too, like. Move on, guys like Corey Nider and James Fish. So ended up playing league, but I think at that point, like I think it was about like under eights or something, under nines. We only had two teams, so would play, bro, literally two teams, bro. So would play on like I think back then would play like midweek would be like a Wednesday, so they'd have Tuesday, Thursday rugby. And then we'll play, train Monday for league. And then Wednesday, we'll play Wednesday for league. And then Saturday would be
rugby
back then. And then I got on to, did all my league up there. And then I think it was about, didn't start getting serious till about league till, I think I was about under 15s, under 16s up there. And I decided just to play league, but a lot of my mates were just playing rugby in league, so play on the Saturday and then play league on the Sunday. And then, yeah, from there, we played for Moody Fennel Falcons, it was called. But
were you any good?
Yeah, so we'd always win the comp up north.
Or was that in the two comp team?
There was about like six teams, probably. Yeah. So there was us, the one up north, and then there was Otawa, which was Kaikawe. Kaikawe Ways, and there was probably about three teams from Whangarei, so that was the comp, and we're mostly having to go up to Whangarei to play, like that, and like those were missions, bro. Like, I was like, fuck, I can't believe we used to do that just to play a game of rugby league. Have to drive 2 hours. But then, yeah, obviously through club, you go on and play reps, which was Northland Sword at the time. And the Northland Sword days, man. They were honestly the best group of boys, but when we'd play, fuck, we'd get palmed. But yeah, experienced my first Northland, like, big
campaign.
Yeah, like national campaign. Like, I guess it starts from like 15, 17, so on onwards back then. But we went to a Northern Districts tournament. And there was only three other teams.
Anyone gun in your team?
No one's really kicked on from my team. There's a lot of boys playing. Oh, Woodamu Greg.
Oh,
yeah. Rachel Parra. There was like Dylan Brown, Paulie T, yeah. Paulie Turner.
Yeah.
There was Lee.
Older or younger? They in your team?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What
do you mean no one's hardly ever kicked on?
Yeah, fuck, who am I talking? Caleb Aikens. He was at Penrith.
Penrith, yeah.
But he was a bit older.
So you said older people in your team?
Hey, he was older.
Did he play in your team?
Nah. Just in
the you guys above. Had older people, people in your team?
We had to if we were playing Auckland. There's a few. Who else is there? That's sort of the main ones. And then yeah, I remember we played in the final of the district comp. It's like Coastlines, Bay of Plenty, and who was the other one? Waikato. So we played in that tournament. That was before nationals, and we're like gunning in that tournament. We're like, fuck yeah, we're gonna black bro, we're mean. And I remember we played Bay of Plenty in the final. We ended up losing because of Hayes Prim, bro, just stepped our whole team and ended up scoring on the hooter.
What, the winning try?
Yeah, the winning try. We're down 18-0 and then we caught up, and then fucking last like three minutes or something, he scored a try, and we're like, fuck.
True.
But then yeah, like we played that tournament. And we're like, bro, we're mean, bro. Like, we're gonna go to nationals and have like a mean crack. And then I remember we played Akarana, like Swain and them were playing.
who else was in Swain's team?
Chanel, there was Swain. I can't remember. I know heaps of boys in their team, but like,
yeah,
they all played all over Auckland.
Oh, Swain.
I think Mikey.
Mikey Williams. Oh, yeah.
Starford. Oh, I think they all, bro, that was ridiculous. I think Dills had played for counties.
Yeah.
And then, bro, we played Akarana and we're like, fuck. Bro, they walk out and we're just like, oh, is that the 17s team or is that the fucking 15s? And we're like, bro, what the fuck?
Because Swain was...
Swain now is now.
Yeah.
But...
can play, dude.
But, I think we only lost by like a try and a little bit, and then the rest of the tournament we just got pumped. And then went through all the swords like 17s. I remember we won our first game for 17s. Man, it was unreal, like the unreal feeling of just like winning a grand final. And we'd like won convincingly too, so it was a mean party. Then yeah, did all that, moved over to Aussie when I was young, played club over there, then moved back. I moved back to come to the Warriors and play 20s.
Yeah.
Did 20s there, played a handful of games that year, and when I'd get dropped back, I'd play for Northcote Tigers.
Yeah.
So that was my first club in Auckland, was Northcote Tigers.
How did you end up there? Like,
gosh, you'd ask this question.
Yeah, like, how did you end up in Northcote Tigers? Out of all clubs,
yeah.
Were you living over the shore?
Nah. So I was living in Avondale. Yep. Avondale. The coach Jeff Morton. He was we worked for the same company.
And he got you the job, eh?
Yeah.
So didn't say we worked for the same company.
Nah. Well, my uncle was working, and then he'd come down one day, and he was like, oh, so Purdy play league, and I was, yeah. So I'll come to Northcote and see if you like it, blah blah blah. So I was, oh yeah, went down and checked it out. You know, a few of the boys like Cole, Trent, that were in Warriors at the time as well, and yeah, ended up liking it. And then I remember I got dropped back, so I ended up playing, and my first game was against you guys, Punchiv.
What year was it?
2018.
Word on the street was that when Jeff asked, do you play league, you like brought up your Warriors profile.
Like he already knew. No. I had no profile at that point.
Word on the street is you showed him a selfie of you and your Warriors kit. Is that true?
That is not true. That is not true. But no, you ended up played a few games, but at Northcote, but played my first game against Punchiv against all the boys.
Yeah.
Which was pretty funny now looking at it. And I guess from an outsider, when you're looking at Punchiv, you hate the clubs. And I hated the clubs, so I made sure I went out and tried to win, but we ended up losing. then the next year again, ended up doing a NRL preseason with the Warriors, and then played 20s in that again at Warriors, and then I think it was 2020. Ended up moving.
Who was in your team? Who was your coach in your team in the Warriors when you first went there?
Ricky. Ricky was the coach. Grunner was the manager.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, Ricky was the coach. He was a good coach. He's a good coach. Ricky Henry was the coach, and then Greg Boulos was the coach. He's an Aussie coach. Came over the next year. He was cool. He was enjoyable. Then went to Aussie to play for Winner Manly in 2020, but unfortunately COVID hit. So I ended up coming home, and then I came home, and then I was supposed to move back. I went straight up north, and then I was supposed to move back down and play for Northcote. But me and a couple of the boys come together, and I'm the person who's just like, we'll go play rugby for the year up north. And I was like, oh, they're like, just stay and we'll have a crack. And I was like, yeah, fuck, yeah, why not? The year's already nearly done, may as well stay up here and be with my family and have some fun with the boys. So I ended up playing rugby.
Did they carry on the comp up there?
Yeah.
Because COVID, everything shut down, eh?
Yeah.
Even they cancelled everything down.
I remember, ended up playing rugby, and I think they only just played one round, so it was just play everyone once and then top four.
Good.
But probably that was probably the most enjoyable, like I guess playing with your cousins and your mates was that was probably the meanest bit. And then had my uncle who coached me a lot growing up. He was our coach, and then we ended up winning. Beating Awanui. We ended up winning that, and that was a party and big a half. Party. Yeah, big party.
Who was that for? Tiraro.
Tiraro, yeah. So, ended up doing that, and then 21, I was a bit unsure on what I was going to do with my life. found out I was having kids, and I was like, oh, shit. And ended up moving to Auckland down to come work with my uncle, and I was looking for a club and went to Northcote, and all the boys were leaving. So I was like, oh. Then went in. I think I was training with Point, come to a few trainings at Point in the preseason. So I was doing, came to Point, and then a couple of the boys from Northcote were going to Mount Albert. And I was a bit unsure on like where I was going to go. And then we had ruled out Northcote because all the boys were going to Mount. And ended up being like, having a thing for Mount and Northcote.
Oh, cut. Yes. Where were we? Northcote.
So ended up having like a decision to go through Mount, or not a decision, but I think I was always leaning towards Point. But I think what kept me at Mount was the boys being there. But obviously knew of yourself and knew Sips. I was talking to Sips and Sifil.
Sif.
Oh, to be honestly, like that, yeah, I was didn't even want to play. It was pretty over league, but then ended up coming to Point.
Deciding to come to Point.
Yeah. Nah, I was always coming. But yeah, ended up coming to Point. Played there for the 2021. Then obviously season got cut short. We had a good run.
I think we spoke about it before, about the first time you played at Point, when we spoke about that you were in Mount Albert and Point Chev's lineup. Yeah, you want to explain yourself for that?
Fuck, you're always going to bring this up. Yep, so because I was going to, I went to both trainings on the game week. On the Tuesday, I went to Mount Albert and the coach, Mount Albert coach goes,
say,
oh,
his name.
Nah, I'm respectful. The Mount Albert coach goes, okay, we're going to split into two teams. The reserves go on this side and top side go on this side. And goes, oh, Brodes, you're going to go with the reserves. I was like, you're fucking kidding me.
That's what he thought of you, a reserves player.
Yeah, and then ended up going to Point Chev on the Thursday. Hello, starting. yeah, went to the Point Chev, and then we played Mount, and we beat them. So
it all worked out. Eh?
Yeah, it all worked out. Then yeah, ended up playing at Point 21. We had a good run, like 18 games, and no losses. So we then COVID came, so that season got cut short.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And then last year, came back to Point. Then yeah, we had another good run through. Ended up making the final and winning the final. Just a good game to play in.
It was a mean game. It wasn't mean at the start.
First 5 minutes wasn't mean. Shit. First 20 minutes, I mean.
I remember because we hadn't played. You know, remember that's because they'd done like two pools.
Yeah.
I don't know how they came up with that or what was the reason.
Weird
structure.
Like, yeah.
And then, yeah, we didn't get to play anyone from the other pool at all.
Mm. Not to the final.
Not to the finals. But I thought, like, we had a pretty hard pool. Obviously, there were some blowout games, but there was no, like, 100 and something blowout games like the other pool.
Like the other pool.
So, coming up against Glenora for the first time for the whole year, was Howick were in our pool, eh? Yeah, they were.
Yeah, we played them in the semi.
So, yeah, we got to play them before, but playing Glenora for the first time in last year was... but it was massive, eh?
Yeah, it was a big game.
It's like we knew what to expect, but we couldn't, like, you can't really prepare because we hadn't played them, so we didn't really know, like, for ourselves what they were actually like.
Yeah, it was probably one of the toughest games
ever
had to play.
By far, like, I think the whole day itself was...
I think the week, hey, was...
Oh, yeah, the week. Yeah, once we knew we were in the final, I think that whole week was... was massive. I think just the buzz and the energy around, like, trainings and the club, especially amongst the boys. I think we end up doing a dinner, eh?
Yeah, at the RSA.
At the bowling club.
Bowling clubs.
Mm. Shout out to Mario and everyone down there at the bowling club. Was that a Thursday?
Yeah, after training. Yeah, Thursday. Yeah. After training.
After training, we went down there and then we had a feed and then done our routine of going to Shisha. And then I think amongst everyone was sort of like trying to take that whole week pretty casually, like in regards to work.
Yeah. I think a few boys had days off or a week off, and we ended up having the week off there after it.
But yeah, that game itself was obvious. Honestly, it was a massive game. Like, our bus ride there, remember we all met up at the club rooms. We all jumped on the bus. Just when we got there, I think a few of us older heads, we sort of knew what to expect in regards to, like, the build up of it. Eh?
Yeah.
We knew that.
What, that would have been your third.
That was my third one, yeah.
Second title.
Second title.
That was my first one.
Yeah. See, so, us boys sort of knew. It was a little different though, because it's usually on Mount Smart number 2.
Yeah.
So you know, we got put in the change rooms where the away teams are.
Yeah.
Which is the furthest change rooms from. The warm-up field.
Yeah.
I remember us getting ready and having to walk all the way over there, and I think just seeing all family and friends in the grandstand. The weather was nice. obviously playing at Mount Smart number one is always going to be a buzz. And yeah, I think for a few boys, the occasion was mean, eh?
Yeah, hard. It was mean. I think especially winning like that whole time from, I guess, when we met up at the club rooms to go to the fields to the next Sunday.
you know what was funny about that too is bro, how many uniforms did we have? Remember, like we had our
we had our
plane strip, we had our like training gear
that
none of us even had, only some of us had
polos.
And then remember
we got about 2-3 different sets of t-shirts.
Yeah, remember we were all gonna wear the white ones there.
Mm.
And then I think Ellie and Vida sorted us out to wear black tees there.
Yeah.
And then Sifo and that had tees for us to wear after.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, fuck. Imagine if we did.
Imagine if we, so they got us some like premiership t-shirts of all our faces on it. And if we had lost, they were getting thrown in the bin.
They were getting sent to the islands.
So it was lucky we didn't lose. But yeah, that whole week was, fuck, it was unreal. Like, I think after the game to Monday was when we stopped, eh?
Yeah, fuck. Just, I think, like, in regards to the game, I think just both teams, like, going to battle. If you haven't seen a Point Shiv and Glenora game before, or even been a part of one, it's a massive occasion, eh? Yeah. Like, I think there's, like we... Obviously, we got boys in both teams. Mm. Not both teams. We know boys in the other team that we're pretty, we know pretty well. Chaz in particular. So when we always play each other, I think it all started from that 2017 GF when we lost to them.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that's when I think the battles really started to happen. And just that game, like, man, if you know Glenora, eh? Their boys are massive.
You got Chase, Bernard, Shane.
Shane in there. You got Tippins.
Then you got young boys, Cards and Isom.
You got Cards and Isom. You got Phil. Pryor. Soaps in there. Yeah, and then you got Chaz. And yeah, just all over. Eh? Their team is just...
it was evenly, on paper, it's...
Yeah.
A good game.
Like, it's a good game.
I think anyone in Auckland, on paper, you ever look at both teams, you're like, fuck, this is going to be a...
Yeah.
Which it was. It wasn't high scoring. It was...
Nah.
Like, it was... Fuck, it was a war, really. Like, fucking both teams fucking throwing their cells at each other. And
it's like watching a boxing match and just seeing two boxers just, like...
Just go at punches, it. Eh? For the full 80,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, for the full 80. Like, that last 5 minutes, like, I think we spoke about it quite a bit before, was... Like, that last 5 minutes was I don't know how to explain it. It was nerve-wracking.
Yeah, it was.
Being a part of it, like, the worst way I reckon you could win a game or lose a game is on the hooter.
On the hooter.
And, like, they had chances to score. And Souls one was a perfect example of that.
Mm.
But again, like, we know we had spoke about Ellie's efforts. Eh?
Yeah, I think it was all the... I guess the older boys or the experienced boys that come up with the efforts to pretty much seal the game. Like there was Ali first when Sol chipped it over and he was the one chasing back and recovered the ball. Mm. If he wasn't there, Sol probably would have scored.
Do you know the funny story after that? Remember Ali was telling us remember he was next to you. Tracked back and he ended up making that tackle.
Mm.
And then I think it looked like someone chucked the bomb on the field. Remember, everyone was just lying around.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, everyone fell to the knees for a rest. I was one of them. Fuck, I was knacked.
I remember everyone, like, the stretching came out and everyone was just lying on the ground. I think that's how spent everyone was. But after that, I think Dills got... Was it? Nah, I don't think Dills... So someone went off anyway. And they told Ellie to go into half. So once we had played the ball and we were going, and then if you ever watch the footage, you watch Ellie and Zen, they're like walking behind the ruck and they're talking to each other. Ellie was telling us that when he got told to go to half, like he was walking, following the play, and he remembers looking at Zen and he goes to Zen, "Oh, what are you playing?" And then Zen goes to him, "I'm half." And then Zen goes to, "What are you playing?" And Ellie goes, "I'm half." And then Ellie cracked up laughing because he said, he was on the left side.
Yeah.
But that's Zen's side. And he was like, oh shit, I'm on the wrong side. So that's how I ended up taking the kick.
Yeah. So even that next set, like there was a big moment from reps because I was fucked. Yeah. Like I was fucking tackling. So I was fucked. And then reps stood up. He took two good carries too. And then there was a big moment from you with that kick. That I think I was just saving myself for that last set because I knew there was only like, there wasn't like a minute or something left, and I knew I had to save myself. So reps ended up taking two carries, and then there was yourself with the kick over Eason. I think like we weren't expecting that good of a kick.
Oh, you've seen it all year, mate. What are you on about?
Yeah, and then it ended up going up over Eason's head and then ended up in the in goal, which was like, you couldn't have got a better kick at a better time in the game. And then we knew, fuck, we just, if we hold them out for this set and don't let them roll, like, we'll win the game. And then, yeah, ended up holding them out for that set and keeping them in their own half, which was good. And then, yeah.
I think a few things went our way, like that time. Like, firstly, yeah, that's how I ended up taking the kick because Ellie was on the wrong side. By the time he had come around, it was final.
Yeah.
So there was either me or Boom Bullet. Boom
Bullet would have went out on a four or something.
Boom Bullet would have ran it. So sorry, Boom Bullet. I stepped in there. And I remember kicking it, and all I remember was Eason putting his hands up.
Yeah.
And I was just so lucky it went over the top. But not only did it go over the top, it kept rolling
in.
And then when we brought our lineup, All I could think to myself was, man, I'm sure this is the last set.
Yeah.
I'm sure this is the last set. And then I think Eason took it, and then James went in.
Yeah.
We spoke about it. He threw that long ball.
Threw the long ball. But I think when in that set, before he kicked it, I think while I was walking and Raps was carrying, I was like looking back at the clock, and that's how I knew, fuck, there's one more set.
Yeah. But then, you know, when he did throw that long ball, we were lucky. Yeah. And like, shout out to Sai. Because remember when Ollie scored his try, that's when Sai broke his foot. So if you, again, if you're watching the game, or if you would go back and watch the game, you see when Sai catches the ball, he limps to the line. But even in the first half, there was a moment in the first half that I clearly remember was Sola. Do you remember when we had a dropout?
Oh, yeah.
Remember when we dropped it out and then Soaps. Yeah. So up it ended up coming infield,
coming back out,
and then going back out, and then ended up throwing
the
wide
ball to Sai. I think was
that before or after he broke his foot?
That was after.
Fuck.
Because that was like the second or the third try of the game. I think it was a try after yours. So they had a repeat set.
Yeah.
And then they boot. I think I kicked it. I drop kicked it down, and then they come back, and I was just like, seen Swap it just go back, and then Sol got sucked in, and then I was like, no fucking way. But and then I seen Ollie and I was like, you know Ollie, he ain't putting his body on the line. And I'm like, fuck, this can't better stop him. And you see Sai just cruising down, and then you see Sola just coming out of nowhere and like literally come out of nowhere and was like boosting down. And of course Ollie chucks his body in front and absolutely misses, and then you just see, I think I was running back too, but I was near the goalpost, and you just see Sol just come diving in, and then you just see him just straight wrap the ball up, and you're just like,
held him up.
And then from there, like when he grabbed it, you're like, yes, he didn't get it. So you knew, like, it was a sign of relief because, like, after it had been digging the line the whole time, and then you let a stupid try. Like, well, knowing us, would let a stupid try like that in too. So,
well, imagine if that had been a try, it could have been 10-12, or you know, 12.
I think that would have been their first try, 10-4 or something.
10-4, then Chaz has won.
Mm.
We could have went into halftime being down
10-12, 10.
10-12, 10. So we're like, you know, like little moments like that again that end up adding to the result was massive for us. But after that. When that set had happened, that last set and the hooter had went, it was, oh.
What were you feeling after the hooter went?
Oh, just instant relief. Yeah, like, I don't know. I had missed the tackle. I got up and they had passed it. And I was behind the whole play, last play. Yeah. And I got up, and as soon as I heard the hooter and I saw Ollie dive on the ball, it's like I just dropped on the ground and just laid on my back and just felt like instant relief.
Yeah.
Obviously, with the, because we had two seasons cancelled.
Yeah.
We had 20, 21 cancelled. Oh, no. 19 and 20 cancelled.
Yeah.
So for us, like, we had trained so hard for like those years, like, and then 21, we thought we were going to have that opportunity, and then obviously COVID ruined that. So then once we had won and the hooter actually went and we had the ball and the game was over for last year, like, it was just a relief.
Because
You know what it's like and how hard, like, all the boys
trained.
Like, you've been amongst it, and even during the league season, like, you know, we were always
together in training.
Yeah, together.
I think that win was built from the year before, no, like
100%.
It was a long time coming,
and that's why I think for me, that's why I felt relief, because if we had lost there, I think all that training and all that
hard work,
whatever we were that we were doing, would have felt like went to nothing. So for me, it was just just enjoying it, but also like a relief for it.
Yeah, hard.
And yeah, you seen like how happy like all our family and friends and that were in the stand, and especially all the reserves boys that were there. Like, I just wish that we were able to take drinks into the shed.
Oh, yeah. Here's us singing the team song, chucking around water and
milk and protein shake.
Oh, fuck, that was depressing, man. Like, it was a mean, like, even now I still watch the team song back and think, like, fuck, that was cool.
Brings back memories,
eh? Yeah, hard.
But yeah, that game itself was a huge game.
Even that week celebrating was pretty unreal. But carry on.
Yeah, you carry on with you. What did you do after that? After that season?
Yeah, so last year ended up moving over to Brizzy. Went to Winnemanley Seagulls. Did some time there this year. Played a few games. And then, wasn't too happy. Obviously, my kids are back home and that. And was just not really happy, I guess, playing over there. So, ended up coming home and then coming back to Point. Obviously, injured now.
Yeah.
But, happy to. I'm always grateful and I love the club. Now I love being here and I see myself here for a long time. But that's a bit of my footy journey. To touch on yours.
Yeah, so my footy journey started a while ago.
40 years?
14, nah. Yeah, a while ago. I'm pretty fortunate and lucky to be part of a family that's pretty sporty. On both sides of my family, especially my mum's side of the family, got a few well-known cousins and uncles who have represented at the top level. I'm pretty grateful to be born of that. But yeah, my rugby league journey started when I was, I think I was like 7, maybe 8. In the place that I was born at the Tully Tigers.
Yeah.
Played a few years there. I've been a bit of a gypsy when it comes to my life because of always moving and whatnot. Yeah. So from there, I played a little bit at Tully Tigers, and then I went to Townsville. I played at Townsville Brothers.
Yeah.
That's a well-known club in Townsville. I've even played in Sydney during my younger grades at the Leichhardt Wanderers. In the Balmain competition. Where else have I played? Those are all basically the places that I've played in Oz before moving back to NZ. Or well, not before moving back, but part of my league journey at NZ. So my family all grew up playing at Richmond.
Yeah.
So there was a no-brainer for me when I came back from Oz that... the league club that I was going to was Richmond. Obviously, it's just down the road from our family's house in Grayland. Yeah, so basically all my uncles, all my cousins that grew up in New Zealand all came through that club. And yeah, so I basically went back, moved back to New Zealand, and I'd done all my league at Richmond. I did play a little bit of rugby when I moved with my mum down to Blenheim. I played a little bit of rugby down there at the Renwick Rugby Club. I also was fortunate enough to represent the Melbourne Red Devils in their, what is it? That's their representative team, where they have like Nelson, Blenheim, and that combined, and they go play like Canterbury and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, moved back to, after all my schooling, was fortunate enough to play 20s, was fortunate enough to play Cup. And
who's some of the boys you played 20s and that with, like, sort of coming through? Because I know you've played with some names and in that.
But so the one thing about us is, like, us in New Zealand is, like, we never had a competition. Like, we've always had the talent, but we've never had a competition where we can enter a team.
Yeah.
So when the Warriors entered a team into the under-20s competition, oh man, our team was crazy. We had the late Sunny Fai, rest in peace to also. We'll go from our fullback. We had Kevin Locke.
Yeah.
For those of you that don't know, we actually had another fullback. He was, I won't say third string, but he ended up being like the third person that we ended up having at the back. Our first person that we had at the back was Ards. Believe it or not,
He
was a fullback, bro. And honestly, growing up, Ards used to be one of the most fittest dudes you'll ever meet. Yeah, man, he used to be fit as hell. So, Ards went over to Oz our last year of school.
Yeah,
played at Cronulla, and then yeah, came back. He wanted to come back because Warriors were putting in the team. So, anyways, he came back and he was our first fullback. After him was another guy named Howie Matthews.
Yeah.
And then once Nobby went to the back, it was game over. Mm. Like, he basically stayed there. On one wing, we had Nuffy Selawini. He's gone on to play NRL, but he ended up playing it as a hooker.
Yeah.
Siu Tonga was another one that ended up playing on the wing, another one that's played NRL. And then in the centres was myself and Pat Arvan, Patrick Arvan. Yeah. So Pat Arvan's another one that's played. One of my close boys, Rusty, who I honestly thought should have made it.
Rusty. Bristow.
Bro, the most talented dude.
Yeah, I heard he was mean back in the day.
Yeah, he's a year younger than me, but got real close with him. And then you go to, like, pretty much there's more people in our team that didn't play NRL.
Yeah.
That did.
Yeah.
So then there's Ice.
Yeah.
Isaac Johns. Dan O'Regan played NRL. He was our captain. Jody Henry was another one that played with us. Then we had like Russell Packer, Ben Matalino.
Fuck.
We had Alejandro Mara, one of our hookers, Aaron Pauly. We had Constantine Mika and Lison. Who else did we have? One of the dudes, Kurt Tahira. We had another guy, Upu. He's played NRL. There's so many boys that
That sounds like a stacked team.
Like a stacked team. Like so many boys. And I don't know how we didn't win it that year, but if you look at the whole comp that year, there was, well, you look at Broncos, there was Dave Taylor, Alex Glenn, Jarrell Yeo-Yi, Josh Hoffman, Corey Norman, Ben Hunt. Ben Hunt got like player of the year. Under-20s that year. Then you look at like Raiders, who won it. You had Josh Dugan, Jared Croker, Sean Fenton, like all those dudes in there. Then you go to like Gold Coast. One of the boys, Kingy, played there. Then you had like Isi Tonga.
Yeah.
Kevin Gordon, Jordan Rapana, Kane. Who was their hooker? Kane Lawton.
Oh yeah,
bro. Like
that's Carl. Is that Carl?
Carl's Lawton's brother. Yeah, older brother. Bro, so you go to like all the teams. Like back then, Penrith were the ones that gave us a good hiding in our round games. Yeah, like, bro, they've always
been good in like
their juniors.
Yeah, juniors. Hey, they're ridiculous.
Bro, like they had Lachlan Coote. They had Masada Yasefa. They had what's the Cook Island fellow that plays over in Super League?
Tinido.
They had Sam McKendry. But they had what's his name? He plays 11 now for the Sharks. He's their captain. Or 12. Wade Graham.
He was like a halfback.
He was a halfback then. But he was on big bucks apparently. So bro, they gave us a good hiding when we played them over there. But yeah, like our 20s year for Toyota Cup and our 20s team was pretty stacked. So yeah, played 20s and then during that year got to play some cup. And then I got injured and then took off to Oz and then I just ended up playing at I went to Souths for the first year, got injured there. And then me and my cousin ended up going to Goodna, which is like in the local Ipswich comp. And then from Goodna, the following year, before I moved back home, I played at Ipswich, the Jets. And then, when
was,
I came
home. Was that when the brothers were the coaches?
Yeah.
Or was that like playing?
Well, it was honestly, everything you're taught what to do, what not to do growing up, that's what you're taught to do.
Shifting on first.
Shifting on the first, offload on the first. It was so refreshing because I had been out with an injury for a little while, so I got into doing like a little bit of CrossFit and doing some boxing, and then it was like something refreshing, not just the same old boring procedures and whatnot. But no lies, they never done defense there.
True.
Like there was no tackle tech, none of that. It was always like con games.
Yeah.
And all these con games were pretty buzzy. Like you have one touch, then you have like dropout touch. So like, bro, no lies. Because I played BRL, which is reserve grade.
Yeah.
So I played BRL there, and every single training we had, no lies, it was called dropout touch. So you have you start off with a team. I think it might be like, so you get split in half, and then I think you might send out three players. So they drop it out underneath the
and
post.
And then you got the one touch to come back and
one
score.
One touch to come back in.
If you score, it's four.
Yeah. So no lies, every single training for the whole year, that's what we've done. Like that was our training. And because, that's the style that they wanted to play, to move the ball all the time. So they thought, they found that valuable for them to use in the game situation. Yeah. So no lies, our BRL team done that the whole year. And we got so good at it and it just transferred over to the game. We lost to a 52-meter drop goal in double overtime to the Redcliffe Dolphins that year.
In the final.
So we made it to the final. And then it was a draw at full time. And then had extra time. It was still a draw. And no lies, like not a word of a lie. Like this dude got the ball. And I think when you just strike it just perfect.
Yeah.
But he was.
And
he just knew.
Yeah.
But he was 50, at least 50 something meters out. And, bro, he just got it. It was the last play, and they just flinged it back to him, and he just put his head down and just kicked it. But I was playing wing at the time, and I was on the side of the post, so I couldn't see it.
If it went through.
But I could see it had the distance. And all I was watching was, I was watching the ball. And I could see it was still in the air, so I could see, it had the distance. All I was watching was our fullback. And our fullback was going to just move side to side, and as soon as I seen him drop his head, bro, I knew we lost.
Fuck. That would have been heartbreaking.
Oh, fuck. Like, I'd rather get thrashed, because then at least you've lost.
Instead of losing on the hooter.
Instead of losing on the
hooter.
And
knowing you can win the game too.
And double overtime as well.
Fuck, true.
Muck was in our team.
True.
So that's when
he
came over to Ipswich.
Yep.
Bro, he fitted straight in because it's he's like.
He's just free going, eh?
He's got so much skill, eh?
Don't say that.
Yeah, I know.
He'll clip it and then posting it on his story. He is just a skillful little fella. He goes hard.
Yeah,
he loves to have a little whack.
Yeah, and he's hearty on defense too.
Not scared.
So and then after that, I done the whole preseason at Ipswich, and then moved back home to help out with my grandparents because they were a bit sick at the time. And then funny story with how I ended up at Point Chef. So I used to come home for Christmas and holidays and whatnot, and I always used to go watch Point Chef.
I heard a story. You've been on more Mad Mondays at Port Chip than what is it?
Then I had played games.
Yeah, like yeah. Oh, yeah, that's it.
I used to come home quite a bit, and then I don't know, just so happened to be times of Mad Mondays and and whatnot. And yeah, I used to always go on their Mad Mondays or go watch their games and support because all my cousins and that were there. But the worst thing was I always used to get nominated to do the undie run because I didn't score any tries. So fuck.
Let the black fella out.
I don't even play, can't. Yeah, I used to trip over all the time. You know what I mean. But nah. Yeah, and that's how so yeah, when I knew I was coming home for to NZ to live, I basically, because I knew the coach at the time who was Zane.
Yeah.
Grant's son. And I had been fortunate enough to play against him.
Yeah.
And then, I had rang him and I said, hey, I'm looking at coming home. Is it all good if I can play like resis or something?
Yeah.
But that's because when I had come home, it was only like a week until the season started.
Yeah.
So I was, honestly, I was just happy just to be coming home. And I was just happy just to have a club to go to. So went to one training, which was a Saturday training, I think. And then the following week they were playing, so then we had the Tuesday, Thursday, ended up training, and then you got told, oh, you're playing center. I was like, oh yeah, sweet, all good, thinking I was playing for the reserves. Then was lucky enough to play center for topside. I was pretty nervous, because all my cousins play there, like my brother plays there, and like I knew all the older boys there, like coming back and watching them, like, you know, all the success that they've had.
Yeah.
So my first game playing for them, and but I was pretty nervous. Yeah. Just putting on the jersey, it was just pretty cool. And Buzzy just being in the change rooms, because I obviously know all of them.
Yeah.
Spent time with all of them, but now I'm actually like
gonna play with them. Yeah, hard.
For me, it was I was pretty nervous and excited at the same time, but. Yeah, and then that's how I ended up at Point, been here ever since.
Well, when was your first year there?
2017.
Yeah. how many titles have you won?
Two. I've been a part of two titles for Point. The whole time I've been there, so we lost the first year, 2017, to Glenora. We won the following, and then we didn't make the finals that 100, it was the Point Chiefs 100 year. Yeah. And then they got two cancelled after that.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Just on Point, because you've obviously been there a long time and you're one of the older boys. I guess what's the culture at Point like? Like, I know we've talked about it and that, but the club, obviously it's a big family club in that and do you want to talk a bit about the club and all that?
Yeah. Point Chiefs massive. Like, obviously it's a successful club in the recent, like, decade or so. But yeah, the culture there, it's, I won't say it's hard to explain. The culture there is a culture that's built on a brotherhood.
Yeah.
On and off the field.
Yeah.
And I think that's all mixed in with hard work.
Yeah.
For people that don't know or people that have never seen it, like, you know, like, we got a good group of boys there. But we work hard.
Yeah. Hard.
You know, like, I always say to, I think me and Boom Bullet were talking about this the other time. A little while ago, we were saying that the mindset that we have at Point Chev is like, yeah, we'll moan and complain about like a training session, but we'll always just do it.
Yeah.
And you know, like, when I first went to Point, man, we used to get wasted. Like one training, like one part of a training was 2400s, like a lap around the track. You know the track that's out there.
Yeah, yeah.
So we had to do 2400s, and each 400 had to be in 2 minutes. So like, if you got back in a minute 30, you got 30 seconds rest.
Fuck.
I don't know the science behind it all, but like, that's what I was brought into Point, like, knowing. And that was the mindset, because when I first came to Point, like, you know, when you go into teams or like clubs and that, and you always have like a group of like the cool guys.
Yeah.
And the cool guys, they don't do fitness or yeah, they, like yeah. when anything gets hard, like
yeah, they always drop out or something or don't have to do it.
Yeah. So like when I first came to Point, like you had the likes of like Maui, yeah. Vita, like Slick, like all of those boys, like
be honest, is that yourself now?
You see me. I might not be at the front, but I always get it done. Hey. But you saw me last year, boy. Boy. Nah. But yeah, like, you know, that's how that was the like mentality that I was brought into Point, yeah. like knowing. It's just like they didn't care who you were.
Yeah.
But especially if you got like the likes of like Vida, yeah. who's played NRL, played international. But he's not complaining. Like yeah. he's just doing it.
But bro's still doing it now.
Oh, bro. He's a freak of a dude.
Unreal, that fellow.
But yeah, like that's the mentality that I was brought into. So when you come into like a culture like that, obviously, you know, you got the off-field antics as well.
Yeah, yeah.
The off-field being like the drinking and the hanging out and whatnot. And you would know, like me, you, and a few of the other boys, like we hang out nearly every day.
Yeah.
You imagine that, like, with a whole group, like the whole group of us. Oh,
yeah, 1 to 7, 1 to 30.
Yeah, 1 to 30. And you know, like we do everything together
yeah.
off the field. So you can just imagine like that translates easily to on the field. So that's what I put it down to. At Point is just yeah, just the brotherhood and the culture, mixed in with hard work.
Yeah. Yeah, that's like a lot of people say like Point Chefs like what do you call it? Brought, not bred.
Yeah.
But like at the end of the day, every club's got money, but that's who's willing to work hard at the end of the yeah. day, I think. And
like you can offer anyone money, but yeah. like are they willing to work and yeah, put in the work? And
it's different, like, you know, like obviously going Tuesday, you only get 2 days a week to train with the team. So I guess working together and working hard, that's at the end of Tuesday, Thursdays is what wins you titles. And I think that's why Point so successful was because of the behind the scenes stuff that yeah. No one sees. So
yeah, that's definitely it. And that's why I say yeah. But you know, if you look on the outside and like yeah. you know, when you said Point's brought, not built.
Yeah.
But like it was brought obviously with like to bring players there.
Yeah.
But you can't say it's not built.
Yeah,
like hard. Bro, like the hard work that's been done by like the boys before I even got there, like Wax and all of those boys, like the foundation that they all laid,
yeah.
or even before them, like Stace and Monty and all that got them out of feeling, and got them into the Fox, like that's built.
Yeah,
you
hard.
Know, it's not like they just overnight success.
Yeah,
you know, like and all of that is yeah, that's built. But I always laugh at all the people from the outside looking in. Like, you know, they always, are you just there playing for money?
Yeah.
But I guarantee you.
I get that heaps, bro. It's honestly annoying.
Right. You look at other clubs. Are you saying that other people are not getting yeah, paid for exactly. money?
Why do I can guarantee everyone, there's, bro, I get, can guarantee every their top 8 players and every team are getting paid more than me.
Yeah.
I can guarantee it.
100%.
Everyone thinks, oh, you're on money. That's why you're there. I'm like,
that's the funniest thing, eh? When yeah. they say, oh, you must be on big bucks. So you guys yeah. are thinking by Ortex and whatnot. But again, it's the money doesn't drive the boys.
No.
It's obviously like we're competitive and we love winning and you know, like we hate losing.
Wow. If I was playing for money, I would have left after that 21 season.
100%. And yeah, like yeah, that's what I put Point Chef.
Yeah, 100.
Being like yeah. What about you?
Yeah, well, cuz I started off at Northcote. I guess because you hear our points the big club, you know, you just learn to hate whoever's good.
Yeah.
And for me, I was like, yeah, fuck Point Chef. Like, oh, fuck, roll these cunts. But
got rolled.
Well, we won. Well, I beat them once. I'm 1-1 against Point. But nah, and then I came to the club, and man, like I haven't looked back here. It's like it's an unreal, like club, like family. my family love the club, and that's probably the big thing for me, is that my family love the club. Like, obviously, you know, we took the boys up north one weekend, and they got to experience up north with all my family, and then you know, after that, all my family come down and watch games and that, and the boys look after them. Yeah. You know, he's all look after them when they come down, and that's probably the main thing for me, is like, my family love the club, and the boys treat me like family. And yeah, it's like you said, the brotherhood's like, yeah, you can't, everyone's like best friends here, like yourself, you're like my older brother. Mm-hmm. And then you got all the older boys in there too, who I look up to. But yeah, just the culture, like, we always come and work hard. And, you know, like, we're pretty well known for it, but we're all pussheads too, like.
And compete hard, eh?
Yeah, hard. We're all at training yelling at it. Like, honestly, if I think we spoke about it before, but if you're at training and we're playing a con game, oh my, the refs get abused. We're all screaming at each other.
Not abused like how, like, you know, like we have respect for the referees, yeah, and the ARL.
Yeah.
But, man, if you come to our trainings, like, shout out to Freeze. And shout out to Toots.
Fuck Toots, actually. Fuck that cat.
Shout out to them for, honestly, the words, the abuse that they cop.
You can tell Freeze gets a bit, like, thing with it when, yeah, you're talking to him. That's why you're like, oh, fuck, I feel like a ratchet cut with it. You can tell he gets a bit, like, you fucking little cunt.
Yeah, like the good thing, bro, the good thing about, like, Freeze is, like, he's done his time of, like, he knows what it's like.
Yeah, hard.
Like, I remember when he first started doing it, I think he didn't know how to react then.
Yeah.
He didn't know, like, you know, what to call and whatnot. But, bro, shout out to Freeze, because Freeze has been on the same journey as us as well.
Yeah.
Coming to the club, like, obviously from Richmond as well, like, new to the game of training, being a trainer.
Mm.
And you've seen the work that Freeze puts into, yeah, us. Is like, he's real particular in his,
mm,
particular in what he does. And, like, he's real, like, to the T. Like,
yeah,
when I say that, like, if he says we're doing 10Ks for the week, like, yeah, we're doing 10Ks, yeah, for the hard week. Like, there's no more and there's no less.
Definitely, and no less.
Yeah, because he's probably, like, that's one thing I like about him. Plus, mm, he's good at reading the room.
Yeah, hard.
Like, if he sees us boys a little, like, flat.
Yeah.
Or, like, you know, not making the times, then he's not one of those ones that are going to try thrash us even,
yeah,
more.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you get nothing out of thrashing, like, a dead, yeah, horse, eh? It's already dead.
Yeah.
So I think, like, with Freeze, like, that's one thing that I love about Freeze, is that he's good at reading the room. And if he feels that, you know, the boys are pushing, but they're still not making the times or whatever, yeah, he's willing to accept that.
Yeah.
Rather than other coaches are like, bro, if we're not making the time on the first one, what makes you think we're going to make the time on the 10th one? Like, like, bro, I don't get people like that. It's like,
make it, fucking, you think I'm not trying?
If I didn't make it in the first one when I got all the energy, what makes you think I'm gonna make it?
You think I'm not trying to make the fucking time, cunt?
You think I'm trying to give us penalties? What do you think?
Hard.
But yeah, that's one thing I love about Freeze, and just, like, yeah, his work ethic that he puts into us, mm, to us boys. He's always got, like, us boys at the front. Yeah. And ready to go, eh?
Hard.
So, yeah, shout out to Freeze. Shout out to Toots. Shout out to, yeah, like, all our coaches, managers, and everything that's been a part of our journey, especially to Mel.
Yeah, hard.
Like, I already spoke about it on the field last year after our final and at her farewell. Like, but she was massive for all of us boys,
yeah,
especially us older ones.
Mm. All the broken old ones.
All the broken old ones. Then you got, like, the old one who's using tape for calf skins.
Wasting a whole row on one calf.
On one calf. You know who you are. A shout out to that guy.
Fucking ninja.
But, yeah, nah, definitely, like, that's what else I got to say about Point Chev as well. Is Point Chev as a club, like, they've always put the players first.
Yeah.
Like, you look at everyone behind the scenes, like, we've got so many people that do so much stuff, yeah, behind the scenes, that get no recognition, but, you know, us players and us boys, like we reap the rewards from all of that stuff. Even like this year, we got a new physio with Gareth coming on board, and then like we got a new manager with our reserves manager, who our reserves manager from last year, who's jumped in, Malu. And then, like, you know, last year we had Jace, Mal, and Uncle Vessi, and Pete, Arapeta. Like, you know, all these people that do stuff behind the scenes that don't get the recognition, like, point so lucky, like, in that sense, that they got so many people that are willing to do the work behind the scenes without getting the recognition they deserve.
Just on that too, like, if you don't know our physio this year, it's Gareth, and you couldn't find someone better that's just come in and just fitted in so well with the boys, eh? Like, that's how I think our culture is like, he's just come in and just, I don't know, just mixed so well with the boys and just brought into our culture, and he's actually seen what we're actually like too, so, yeah.
Because he's always coached his son at point, eh?
Yeah,
but
yeah,
he's never been a part.
Yeah.
So, like, I think for him, bro, it was a bloody mission to find a physio at the beginning of this year.
I know.
When Mal left, like, Mal had been the physio for as long as I've known, alongside Terry and Chow and that. But ever since I've been at point, like, Mal's been one of the main physios there. And with Mal, whatever says goes, just that respect that all the boys have for Mal. And then, like you said, now Gareth coming on board, like, man, it's a funny story. We'll get into that another time. But it's a funny story how he ended up getting Gareth and... yeah, like you said, he's just fitted in with the team, like, like you wouldn't believe, and just what he does for the boys as well. Again, like, that's the recognition that needs to be said or mentioned. And yeah, I think, like, if he didn't fit, I think it would have been a hard process for all of us to deal with. So we're lucky he fitted in and he's enjoying himself there.
Yeah, hard. But now back on the cult, point as a club for me, like what I was saying before, was like the brotherhood is unreal. Like, I have you, who I look at as like my older brother, and then I got like my other boys, like Dills, who, you know, like, I'd do anything for, you know, they're like my brother's brothers, you know, and it's hard to find those relationships in teams. And I think it's like, it's different here at point, and that's why I always say it's different at point. Like, it's brotherhood. It's not like your brotherhood on a Saturday where it's just a Saturday. It's brotherhood every day of the week. You know, we're always checking up to see if everything's all right. If one of us is having babies, you know, it's all love. So that's what I love about the club, is it's a family club. My family love the club.
It's genuinely like a brotherhood where, like, we do everything off the field. Like, even, like, you talk about, like, we always check up on each other. Like, whenever there's, like funerals or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it might not be all of us, but at least a few of us.
Yeah.
Like, always turn up and try organize something in regards to, on behalf of the team.
Yeah.
So that's something I find is hard to find I can't say other clubs or teams because I don't know what it's like, but I know that what we do there at Point is special.
So we'll move on.
Speaking of Gareth and that, like, you know, the physio side of things, like, we'll talk about our injuries.
Yeah. You want to go first?
You've
got the most. you've had some pretty serious more serious than myself, but you've had some couple of...
I think your last one's been more serious than any of mine, mate.
Yeah, but you've got more serious. But you've had a bit more and bit more serious ones. Just want to tell us about what it's like going through... talk about what you've had and then what it's like going through all of that.
Yeah.
Physically and mentally.
Yeah, I had. Where do I start? I was always like that... the kid who used to boast about never ever breaking a bone. I don't know how long ago that was now, but for ages I never broke a bone at all. Wasn't until I think the first bone I ever broke, I ended up breaking both of my arms at the same time.
True.
we were at school, running backwards, just tripped on the court, and then just landed on like both palms flat on the ground. And I think I remember I got taken to A&E, and then they put a cast on one, but then I ended up feeling the pain in the other when I got home. So I ended up going back and getting an X-ray, and then ended up finding out that I had broken both my arms. Anyway, so through league and footy, done my Achilles. I've torn my Achilles. I've broken both of my arms. I've had two ACLs. One I just let heal naturally.
Yeah.
And the other one I had surgery for. But my most serious one, I've had like little broken bones like in my foot, in my arm, like in the grand final.
Did you do your ACLs back to back or sort of two different times apart?
Basically back to back. So funny story with my ACL. So when I first moved to Oz, I played in a trial game for the Jets and got caught in a tackle and literally like done something to my knee. I didn't know what it was because in Oz they didn't have ACC, you know that.
So
like going to see like a doctor or someone is pretty expensive. It's like
health insurance.
Yeah, so you got like Medicare.
Yeah, Medicare. That's it.
Unless you have private insurance, which we didn't have at the time because it was literally like within the first 2 weeks I think of moving there. I played in a it wasn't for Ipswich, it was for South Logan. Played on a trial game for Cup and then ended up doing something to my knee, but I didn't know what it was. And they had told me that it was my ACL. But me being young and naive, I didn't know what that was. So I basically just left it and I basically stayed away from footy, stayed away the whole year. Come to the back end of that season, we had like a, do you know what Perla is? Like the Pacific Island Rugby League comp that they used to have here. So like in Oz, they have this like thing where they get all the islands, so like Tonga, Samoa, Maldives, Cook Islands, and they play in a comp.
Yeah.
So we played in this comp. I was playing for, Sa. And last tackle of the game, like I made, like came and made a tackle. And then someone had joined in, but I tried to put my leg behind him to trip them.
Yeah.
When I put my leg behind him, that dude that was helping me tackle like dropped down. So he had wrapped my leg and his leg together.
Oh, true.
So when I had tripped him to fall, my leg got caught.
Yeah.
But I had this massive as like ball on my leg. Like it looked like all the tendons and it came up into my thing.
Yeah.
My knee. So that was the second time that I actually went and had surgery after that.
Shit.
So yeah, so basically stayed off league. So done it at a trial game, stayed off league for like the whole year, didn't play nothing, and then played in that little comp.
Yeah.
Then done it fully.
Yeah.
Where I couldn't walk. So then that's when I had an op, and then basically that's how I got into CrossFit.
What's it like? Like obviously. Doing your ACL is pretty, like, tough. And then, but what's it like mentally doing it first and then playing another game and then doing it again?
Yeah. Mentally, it's tough because it's like a 9-month, you know, like they say 9 to 12 month process.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, the hardest thing I think mentally for it is knowing that, like, you could get to month 9 where you're ready to go and then it can go anytime and then it's just like your whole process starts again. So I think mentally is that, and that's why I think a lot of people are real cautious about coming back after ACLs or long layoffs because they know the process that comes with the injury. And it can be a real hard process, especially it could be a real lonely process actually. Because those of you that that know like that have done your ACL, like, you know, there's no one else with you.
Yeah.
Like, especially if you're on a club or a team.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you're usually on your own doing your own rehab. And, you're basically just you and the trainer.
Yeah.
So it can be become a lonely process. It can become a long process and it can also become a frustrating process because there's also people out there that obviously each injury is different. So like you might have an ACL, I might have an ACL and then do it at the same time, but your body might heal faster than mine.
Yeah.
So like if me and you are in rehab together and I see you running and I'm still like on a bike because I can't run. Like, you know what I mean? Like that can be, that's what I mean by like, it can be like I'm frustrating.
Yeah.
So I found that like my time with my ACL, the second time around, that was the main reason why I got into CrossFit was to stay away from the game of rugby league.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you know what it's like if you're around, like if you're injured and you're constantly around it, like you get itchy feet.
You get the itchy feet.
And then when you get the itchy feet, then like, you know, you start telling your mind mentally, oh, no, I'm good.
Yeah, I'm good.
I'm good. I'm good. And then you...
Hey, why are you explaining everything I'm going through, bro?
See? Well, there you go. So that's where I talk about, like, you know, the injuries and whatnot with my ACL.
Yeah.
What about...
Your neck, you want to talk about?
Oh, yeah. My neck's one that's been spoken about plenty of times before when it comes to injuries. Yeah. In 2008, I think you're thinking about it.
How did you break your neck?
When I look back at it now, but a lot of things went into that day. But I broke my neck playing in a game I wasn't meant to play for Richmond at the time.
Yeah.
Against Manurewa, and I think it was 2008. I think it might have been a Fox game, or Fox. I think it was a Fox game. Yeah, basically just got caught in a tackle crusher.
Tackle.
And that's how I broke my neck. But like looking back at it now, like I've spoken on this many times before, it's like there were signs to that day. So Sponge was our coach for 20s. I was playing 20s at the time. And then I had just come back from an injury. So I played a game. And I was going to play a game for 20s after we had a bye or something. And I had just come back from injury, so I wanted to get some game time. So I asked Sponge if I was allowed to play. And Sponge goes, oh, nah, just have a rest. So I was like, oh, yeah, all good. But, you know, like, I don't know what it's like. But, you know, when you grow up at a club that you're, like, you know, like that's your club.
Yeah.
And so I grew up coming through the ranks at Richmond, and I've really played topside and whatnot. But, I always used to go to training. Like there's a couple of us, me, Manu and all that, we used to go to trainings where we'd go to 20s trainings, and then we would train like early. So by the time we'd finish, we could rush back to
go to
Richmond training. Yeah. And train with the topside and all of that. So we used to, like, I used to do that all the time. Like I love doing that, and like, you know, get to Richmond training, turn the t-shirt inside out. Yeah. You know, you don't want to come down there in your full kit.
Yeah.
Or bring some spare gear or whatever and then jump into training and just being around, like, you know, older dudes. Mm. So when I didn't play 20s, I would always go back and play at Richmond.
Yeah.
Yeah, so then when I had the opportunity, or I didn't have the opportunity, but when I wasn't playing, I asked if I could go back, and I asked the club, the coach at the time, if I could play. And yeah, all good. So I went back and played in a game. But leading up to that day, like, there were so many things that now that I look back at it, that were like signs that I shouldn't have played.
Yeah.
But there was also, I would say, miracles that happened on that day to me being able to recover, I reckon.
Yeah.
One of them, for example, was like, I'm never late to games, but I was late to the game that day.
Yeah.
I'm never the last one out of the change rooms, but I was the last one out of the change room. Something buzzy about that day too is like, that day when we played Rewa, there was a, on the wing for Rewa on my edge, apparently he was a doctor.
Yeah.
And that was his first ever game for Rewa.
True.
So like when I broke my neck,
he was the first.
He knew what to do.
Yeah.
And it was lucky that the physio from Rewa had ran on, and, she said she heard something, and I said to her, can you help me up? Because remember, I just came back from my injury. I said, oh, can you help me up? And then she was like, oh, I think you broke your neck. And I was like, hey, like, nah, I'm all good. And she goes, oh, can you feel your legs? But I tried to move my legs there. I couldn't feel my legs. Anyways, long story short, yeah, I ended up breaking my C5 and C6. The disc came out, and I completely smashed my C4. So, bro, I was pretty lucky in the sense that I can still walk and play,
you know?
Because that's what the Warriors were told, and I was told, like, but you'll never play rugby league again, like, let alone walk, like you'll never walk again. Wasn't until went and done the scans in it, and they explained, just, you know how we're always told that Islanders, Maldives, big bones,
yeah,
it's not. Our bones are bigger. It's just like the space in between our bones are bigger.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what basically saved my life.
True.
Or not my life, or saved my legs and my arms.
Yeah.
Because if that spacing was of a
bit smaller.
Yeah, balangi. The disc like touched my cord. That's why I couldn't feel my legs, because it was cutting that. So it was touching the cord like this. I mean, that's because the spacing like that was that wide and my cord was in the middle. So if I was like, if my thing was like that and the cord was in here, it would have came out, cut it easy. So that's how I basically survived from being a quadriplegic to where I am now. Being Quadzilla, look.
That's crazy, eh?
Yeah. But, yeah, like all injuries, like that was a, mentally, that was a hard one. That was the reason why, like, you know, when you were in hospital, like I know that feeling of being in hospital and not being able to do anything and just being stuck in there all day.
Yeah.
Like, no lies, I could tell you how many holes were in the roof. Because for 2 weeks, no lies, I couldn't move. Like,
yeah,
I was just in that, like, position where I had to just lie on my back and I couldn't move my head side to side.
Yeah.
I was stuck in the position of looking. So everyone that came into my room when I was in hospital, like, I couldn't see their faces unless they came and put their faces over the top. Or someone held a mirror and I could see everyone.
Fuck, that's buzzy ass.
Yeah.
A little... Well, you actually told me when you're in hospital, big odds was
that's where you became big odds.
Yeah, yeah. But I remember you telling me when you're in hospital, odds used to come get you, and you ended up at a Warriors game.
Yeah. Oh, so like I said, like we were with the 20s at the time, and me and odds had come up with a plan. Well, mainly odds, you know that guy. Always going against the grain, and that's why I love, like, I love Ards, because he's the type of dude that a spur of the moment, I don't care, we'll just do it.
Yeah, hard.
And we've always been that type to like egg each other on.
Yeah,
bet you can't. Anyway, so he had come and picked me up from the he drove to the hospital. He was there every day.
Yeah.
Eating all the food that people were bringing, because I couldn't obviously eat any of it, and he came, and then we had hatched a plan to like go to the Warriors game. So I had a halo on. I had a halo on at the time, and I had those gowns. You know those gowns.
Yeah.
I had a gown on, and he brought me like this jacket. Do you remember those big jackets back in the days? They were like just your normal jacket, but then they had the fur around the top.
Yeah. I think they still make those like now. I think I still see people.
My one was like this, like Louis Vuitton one.
Sure. On the water party.
No, so I put this on, and I had the gown, and I we basically like took me to Mount Smart.
Yeah.
And I think the boys were playing Penrith. It was a semi-final. I remember it clearly, because we went there, and then they took me into the coach's box.
Yeah.
And Sponge and that were there, because you know, like when you watch the Warriors games, they always show the coach.
Yeah.
The coach's box.
Yeah.
And you know, you can see the players and that in the back. This one shot, because it was a massive game, because this is when Ruben Wiki knocked out Sia that game.
Oh yeah.
So we had played Curtin, the boys had played Curtin Razor to that, and it was against Penrith. And the last time we played Penrith, remember I told you they pumped us.
Yeah.
So anyways, they had played Penrith, and that's why me and Ads took off. Anyways, I was sitting in the back, and then I think something must have happened on the field, and then they like showed like a shot of the coach's box.
Yeah.
And you can just. I don't know. I'm not watching the game. Yeah, like I'm not watching the game on TV. But you can clearly see me in the background, like sitting there, like
with your halo on.
With my halo on and the little fur bit around.
Yeah.
All right. And then it wasn't till we went back to the hospital, and the nurses and they were like, "Hey, oh, where did you go?" And I can't remember what we had told them. We had lied to them. And then someone had come into the room. One of the nurses had come into the room and said, "Hey, were you at the Warriors game?" And I was like, "Hey, nah, who said that?" And then apparently they had seen me on the TV in the background. And they were like all cracking up, because, you know, like we snuck out there and they didn't know.
Yeah.
Then that's how we got caught. So, that's like times like that, like, and people like that are like, are basically what keep you sane.
Yeah, hard.
Because you know what it's like being stuck up in a place like that. You can easily fall into, like, go the opposite way.
Yeah, hard.
Can easily get on top of you and you can start thinking stupid stuff.
Yeah.
So, like, times like that, there was plenty of times like that, like, heaps of things that I'd done in my time when breaking my neck where, if you were to look at it, you'd be like, "Bro, you're just dumb."
Yeah.
Or not dumb, but, like, you're out of it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm grateful for those times and those memories because those are something that I'll have, like, for the rest of my life. And those are something that I can look back and use as how I got, like, myself right. But, yeah, it's still a battle in itself.
Yeah. Good.
What about you? You want to tell us a little bit about your injuries and especially your latest one?
Yeah. I haven't obviously had too much injuries growing up or while I was playing footy, which I've been pretty lucky.
You're still young anyway, though.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel a bit old. Body feels old. A bit mature. I haven't had too many injuries, like, growing up in that, which I've been pretty lucky about. I've only had, like, little like, things that'll keep me out for a few weeks, like little niggles and that, nothing serious, like ACLs, and or I've never had to get surgery or anything like that, which I've been pretty lucky for. But yeah, my most recent one, I had a brain hemorrhage. I think.
Why do you say hemorrhage? Like, well, you know what a hemorrhage is.
That's what it was called. Well, I don't know.
How do you spell it?
Hemorrhage. E-merge. they said it was like a brain hemorrhage from concussions. So I had a couple of concussions. And then I got into one really bad.
You say you got into a couple of concussions. You got a couple of concussions like this year or just like in general?
Nah, just before? Just this year. Like, I've had like hits to the head, but never really had any bad concussions or anything. But this one in particular got smoked right in the head. Like, when I say smoked, I mean shoulder straight to the head, taken off.
But, boy, let's be honest, he's not the smallest dude either.
No. He's the biggest follower on the field. Shit. And when he's coming in full pace, full strength, right at the head, I'm surprised my brain didn't come off out of my head. But ended up getting a late hit in the head. I remember going down and then trying to milk a penalty, which we got. And then I ended up coming up, like, standing. It was at half time, and then the hooter went sort of when I got tackled. And then we went to go for the 2 points. And then I was kicking that day, and then I was like, "Oh yeah, I'll kick to Dills." And then I remember getting the ball and then looking at the goalpost, and I was like, "Oh fuck!"
That's just quickly. That's second and third string kickers, eh?
You know I'm number one. Kicker. You know I'm number one. Everyone in the team knows it too.
Hell no. You and Dills are second and third string
kickers. I just let you kick because I'm nice.
You let me kick because when the pressure's on, they're going through the sticks. Anyways, carry on.
Ended up looking at the post and I was like, fuck, there's three goalposts. I was like, oh, bro, I'm not kicking. Ended up chucking the ball to Dills. I was like, here, you kick. And then I ended up calling, I think it was maybe Toots or Gareth. I was like, bro, come get me, like, a bit dizzy. So ended up coming to get me, and then I walked off the sideline. Sat at the bench. Fuck, I just felt sick as my head just had the mean headache at the moment. Then ended up spewing up. I started to feel all right, feeling like I could go back on, but then I was watching the game, and then if I had to go on, I would have went back on, but it's probably lucky I didn't.
They wouldn't have put you on anyway.
Probably not.
Especially the way that you looked on the sideline.
Yeah, I was pretty dead.
Well, actually, you look better than what you do normally, but.
Oh, I honestly looked dead. And
like, you look pale, eh?
Mm. And then I ended up just sitting on the sideline because my head was just so sore. And then showered up. Even showering was just hard to do because I just couldn't stand up.
Because you never do it.
Because I couldn't stand up. And then I remember I had my kids at the time and my old lady and that were down and my siblings and I was like, fuck, just take me home. Like, just want to go home. Ended up sleeping like the whole car ride home and then because I had my kids, I was like, to my old lady, I was like, fuck, you got to look after the kids. Like, I'm going to bed. Ended up going to bed and just sleeping right through the night. The next day was my kid's birthday and felt all right that day. And then, yeah, had a couple of weeks off training and playing. And then came back against Monaco. I remember we were playing Monaco. And
did you see, because you said that you had time off and that did you have to go see, like, doctors and any other? Yeah,
so I went and seen the doctor and they just ruled it as, like, a concussion. Nothing else happened from it. Just gave me some pills and that to get through, like, the headaches. Because I was having the mean headaches, eh? Like, it would be wake up and just, like...
Throbbing,
like, just... Didn't even want to get out of bed, really. Like, I'd just lay in bed for ages and then end up being at work and then my head would just throb even more. So I'd just go home. And then, yeah, they just said, oh, it's just concussion. Have a couple of weeks off and you'll be all right. So I had a couple of weeks off, went and played against, yeah, Monaco, about 15 minutes in. I remember, like, walking around and Soaps scored in the corner and then I went to go walk over and I was like, my vision just started getting blurry and I was like, oh, fuck. And I can't remember who was behind me. I think it might have been Ollie and Zen.
Mm.
I was like, fuck, I can't feel my legs. And then I remember just buckling, like my legs just buckled underneath me. And I remember just going on all fours and I was like, fuck. And then from then out, blacked out. And I ended up having a seizure on the field in that time. And then I remember waking up and everyone was around me, like all my family, all you boys, all the staff were around me and I was like, fuck, like, what's going on? And I remember they were asking me questions and like, oh, where are you? And I remember trying to talk but I couldn't talk. It felt like someone like just had their mouth over my hand. I was like, and couldn't talk. And then ended up coming to talking and honestly, like I didn't know what had happened and I remember them asking me questions and I remembered everything and I was like thinking like, oh yeah, fuck, sweet, I can play again.
Yeah.
Like I can keep playing. And then I remember they're like, oh, we'll sit you up and then see if you feel sick. And I remember sitting up and then fuck, I just chucked everywhere. I was like, oh fuck. And then I remember like after that just lying back down and then just feeling so drained from like the seizure and then trying to go to sleep. And then I remember just lying there and just like looking around at everyone and then like seeing all my family there and like crying, like my little brother especially, he was there just bawling and I was like, fuck, what's going on? Because I was just, all I was doing was just trying to go back to sleep.
Yeah.
I think it was a scary time for them too, watching that and that.
So. Definitely. Well, you know, when I saw your little brother.
He thought, bro, honestly, like I thought you were dead. That's how pretty scary it was, like, and my stepmom and my old man were like, bro, you're like dead or like gonna die.
Mm.
So, yeah.
Well, you can see how scary that is for them, like, you know, not knowing what's going and thinking that you're gonna die. How was that? How was, like, obviously you're still recovering and you got a little process still to go.
Mm.
How have things been for you mentally since the injury? And that's not a pun either, like we're not, you know, mentally, like your brain. But how has things been for you mentally? And yeah, like tell us some stuff that like, you know, you've gone through since having the injury.
Yeah. Oh, so I had a brain bleed. So I had a CT scan, ended up having a brain bleed and there was a lot of old blood in my brain that was just sitting there, which caused me to have a seizure, but I think because it was old blood, I didn't have to get surgery or anything, which I was pretty lucky for. But yeah, mentally, I think mentally it's been, I wouldn't say hard, but more so grateful.
Mm.
Like, obviously, we know, there was a guy the exact same day, Tere from the club, rest in peace to him. But he sort of, I guess, went through that same process that I did on the exact same day, and unfortunately he passed away, like, due to that. I think he was in a coma and didn't wake back up. So when I heard about that, obviously he's got close family ties to the club, being Susie's brother and that, but hearing about that sort of made me grateful and lucky. And then the next week on, Adrian went through the same process again, and then ended up having surgery and stuff. And mentally I'm pretty strong, and I was all right. I got to go home and be around my family and my kids. So for me, mentally, I didn't have much time to, I guess, think about it. Or
because you went straight back up north.
Yeah, so I come out of hospital, and then because I had to be on watch in case anything happened, I went straight back up north by my family and had my kids with me too. So that was probably the good thing about it. And then but like that whole process was like, I can't complain about anything. Well, I have nothing that can bring me down, was because I knew there's a couple of other boys that will probably never be the same again. Well, one passed away, you know, and Age, who's Adrian, I don't know him personally or anything, I just know of him, but he'll probably never get to play rugby or anything again. So yeah, I'm lucky, and I just think, like, fuck, it could have been worse. I could have died, I could have had surgery and probably never been able to play league again. But yeah, like, more mentally, I'm just like lucky, you know, because there's just talk. I'm just talking with like doctors, and then they said everything's going smoothly, and that I'm lucky.
Yeah.
So
it's like you said, you don't realize things until you put it into perspective. And like you said, like, someone has passed away, and someone may never be the same again. Like I know Age personally, and I know that he's got a long road ahead of him, and I wish him nothing but the best on his recovery.
100%.
I hope that he does get to play rugby again, because I know just how important or how much he loved rugby. But yeah, like as bad as your injury was, like, bro, let's be honest, that's your brain. Like, you only got one brain. Like, but then, like, and that's bad. Like, injuring your brain is, I don't know what else is worse.
Well, because if your brain did, like,
You're
basically dead.
Yeah, you know, so.
And I remember Shante and Huppy, when they came up to the hospital, because he went through similar stuff like concussions, and that forced him to retire. But he's like, the tricky thing about your brain is like, your body feels good to play. And my body does feel good to play, like I could feel like I could play tomorrow. But he's like, because you can't see your brain, that's, you know, that's the hard part.
Yeah.
Your body feels good, but your brain's not.
Yeah, heard.
Not there yet. So
that's what I always talk about, like mental battles. Is like, remember how I was talking about with my like knee and whatnot, and I find that like, but you could physically feel ready to do something.
Yeah,
like you could have done like all the rehab and everything possible for like any injury you want, but if you're mentally not ready to go back,
yeah, hard.
That's why I say the ACL is one of the hardest injuries to come back from. Mentally, because you just know if you do the exact same, and it's easy to do your ACL.
Yeah.
Like, if you just do the exact same thing again, like, it's like someone just pushed the reset button, or someone turned the switch off your game, and you have to start over, like, all again. So, I think, like, when it comes back to, like, injuries, like, mentally, you have to be ready and prepared.
Yeah.
If you're not ready and prepared mentally, and you haven't, like thought about it, and you're just doing it just because, you know, it just feels right.
Yeah.
But I guarantee you, like, you'll run into, you either get injured again, CrossFit, like, touch wood, like, you know, you're more than likely to get injured again, or you're more than likely to injure something else.
Yeah.
Trying to compensate for that injury. Mm. Eh?
Yeah. Hard.
So, like, I know for yourself personally, like, you know, you've come back down from up north, and, obviously all your family up north, you still got like, you know, some family here and like all of us boys and that here as well. But like I know for a fact, like there's gonna be challenges and times that are ahead for yourself, because like that was your first time on Wednesday, just going being around the boys,
yeah, hard.
During a league game, and you want to tell us about like that experience, like obviously knowing physically you can play,
yeah,
but then obviously now you know you got a restriction mentally that you know you can't be out there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you want to tell us what it was like being around the boys on Wednesday night and having that feeling of being in the shed and running the water?
Yeah. It's hard. Like, it is hard. Like, you get itchy feet. Like, I got the biggest itchy feet. I think just being in the changing room with the boys was like, fuck. Like, fuck, give me a jersey, man. Like, fuck, let me put the jersey on. But it is hard watching. I think I was pretty, like, lucky. Like, they let me run the waters.
Yeah.
Because if I was standing on the sideline, would have been harder. Whereas if I'm on the sideline running the waters, I can help, you know, the boys. And I love helping
still
the boys.
Still feels like you're part of it.
Yeah, Feels like I'm a part of the team. And I'm pretty lucky for that I get to do the waters and stuff like that and help them in some way I can. And funny thing, like, they're like, the coach is like, yeah, you just got to come and you know, come back. We'll give you a message, take it back out to the boys. I wasn't even going back to get the message. I was just giving my own messages. I think I was even telling you, they're like, were you giving the right messages? I was giving my own. But
that's always the case.
Yeah, it ended up being the same message anyway, so it was all right. But like watching is hard, especially when you know, like, you know what I'm like with the boys. I'm a team guy, and I love getting around the boys and pumping the boys up and that. And but yeah, I guess I just have to for now do it from a different point of view and just watch. But I guess like in those frustrating times when someone drops the ball or something, I'm like, fuck. You know, saying the same words as you're saying,
even if it is myself dropping the ball.
But I guess for now it's something, you know, I have to get used to and just take my time with coming back. But for now, I'm just running the waters.
So. Yeah, yeah. Well, like anything, like, you know, things take time.
Yeah.
And I guess, how do you put it? Like, having a good system in place for yourself and having good, like, a support base, those are the things that I reckon help me along the way. Especially through, but I've been like, I don't know if I show it or not or enough or whatever, but man, I've been through some real like dark times, like not only, oh, that's just life in general. We all go through our dark times, but again, it's just how we deal with like those times. And I've had times where like, bro, I'd rather not be here. This world's not like, this world don't need me, like being through those places. And then I've been like on top of the world, like where I am at the moment, mentally a bit comfortable, as you can see. But yeah, like, you know, I at the moment, I'm just finding like that balance, and that's crucial in life, I reckon. Like, I can only speak for myself and my experiences, but like, I just know like there's a lot of guys out there, men especially, Pacific Islanders and Maldives, who too stubborn.
Yeah, hard.
Like mentally, like, yeah, I guess I think we had spoken about it before. It was about just, we're never taught to show our emotions, especially like, not our sad or crying emotions.
Yeah.
So like, we've always been the type to never show it, or if it is, it's like at least as possible. Because you you ever noticed like when guys cry, they like have a couple of tears and then it'll be like, then all good.
Yeah.
Then it's just like, you know, and you know that the saying goes like, men don't cry.
Yeah.
But like all of that stuff, I find like, I think that's just how it's been growing up is just like all our like family and that have come through before us, like they've been brought up to be tough. Can't show emotions and you can't show your weakness. So I think like those traits have filtered down. But again, like those can be our downfall. In our mental battles.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on like that kind of stuff?
Mental health?
Yeah, like your like dealing with mental battles and like mental stuff and what's your general thoughts about it?
Yeah, like me and you have talked about it a lot, especially the other day. But like for me, my I guess everyone goes through those dark times, and I guess it's how you come out of those dark times is what makes you who you are. But for me, like myself personally, is I like to deal with my mental health or my problems, issues, and going to those dark places. I like to deal with it myself. Because for me, if I go through, you know, hardship or a dark time in my life, I like to go for it with myself. And what I mean by that is, like, for me personally, is at the end of the day, the only person that can help you is yourself. And if you're not willing to help yourself, then I don't know, like, if you're not willing to help yourself, then, you know, how are you supposed to get better or get through those hard times? Don't get me wrong, like, I haven't, like, obviously reached out to, like, my mates and that, and, like, people to talk to. But for me personally, like, I like to go through those times by myself, because if I do go through those times, it's like, yeah, I know I can get through them by myself. And for me, I don't like to put my burdens onto anyone else. Right. And if I can't get through those times by myself, I do go to...
You're not scared.
Yeah, I'm not scared to go to people or friends or family. But for me personally, I like to deal with...
Like yourself before.
Because for me, I'm a person that enjoys my own company. And like I said before, I've talked to you before about, like, you got to be comfortable in your own skin and be comfortable in your own presence and within yourself. Yep. And I think there is a lot of people who don't like the comfort of being by themselves. They have to be around other people or don't like to... or don't like to be in their own presence or anything like that. But for me, I enjoy being in my own presence. You know, I like to... The ways I do that is, like, I always go out to eat by myself or just drive around, sing songs or whatever.
Put the music on.
Yeah. And just find ways to feel comfortable with myself and be happy within myself.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've been through some dark times. Obviously, times where, you know, I thought I wasn't wanted in this world or didn't want to be in this world.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess it's how you come out of those times, and that's what makes you who you are. And I know a lot of people like struggle talking to people, but struggle talking to people, but I think, like, my advice to someone would be, if you, like, try to fix things within first, and then obviously look to reach. But at first, like, back ages ago, I used to think, you know, mental health was all shit, like what the fuck is, you know. But as you get a bit older and you take on a bit more responsibilities, there are things that can take you to those dark times. And it might be just the littlest things too. Like, the littlest things can bring you down, like, big time. So
that's one thing that I've learned is, like mental health has no, like, criteria. Like, they don't care how old you are. Doesn't care, like, what you look like.
Yeah.
Doesn't care, like, what gender you are. Doesn't care, like, what you're going through at the time. But, like, your mental battles are it's just something that can just happen out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And bro, they can like change the course of your life. Like we had spoken about, like obviously everyone goes through their own mental battles and little battles themselves. But yeah, like I was the same. I always used to think that's just because of our upbringing was.
Yeah.
Like all these people talking about mental health and whatnot, like, but like just weak.
Yeah, hard.
It's not till like, you know, you understand like, oh, actually I'm going through something now. It's like, oh, fuck, is this what like they're talking about? Like, is this like mental health? And then, but mental health can be so draining.
Yeah, hard.
Like, you know, when you go through stuff, like sometimes like you just don't want to do anything. You just want to stay home. Like I remember last year a couple of times where I would be at work and you know when you just get that feeling of like, it's not overwhelmed, it's like the anxious feeling. But no, not a word of a lie, but I'd always just lie to like my boss and say like I didn't want to tell him I was having like mental issues or like, you know, like
Hard.
So like I would always like lie, but the one thing that I learned was like I'm starting to learn to is talk about my emotions to Charles.
Yeah.
So when that would happen, I would tell my boss like, oh, like I'd make up an excuse that I got to go home, but I'd literally tell Charles on my way home like, I'm not feeling good today. I'm not feeling good. Like I'm going home, and then I'd literally get home, no lies, I'd close all the curtains, and I'll just put the TV on, jump in bed, and I'll just lay there and like not want to do anything. And then that's when I knew like, bro, this is for real. And I'm a little bit the same as you, and a little bit in the opposite direction as well. Like I feel like you got to be willing to change to make a change. But I also feel like asking for help, like is important. Like, so, you know, like sometimes like we can feel like that pressure. No, like we can feel like we can get in that mind state of I don't want to burden them, like, you know, and or the other mindset where we can be like, oh, I don't want them to know my problems. You know, that's why I always say like a safe space and a safe circle that you're comfortable with is huge when it comes to like your mental battles and whatnot, because if you can't trust the people around you to speak openly about like what you're going through. And I've found other people have said that they've found comfort talking to like a random about their problem. Just so there's no like judgment coming back. And I've found that like with myself, like I might not tell like the boys or whatnot, but I'll tell like Charles. And I'll speak to her like about stuff, and it's been mean like that I get to speak to her about stuff is because now like, because before I was the type to always bottle everything up. And then, you know, once the bottle's had enough.
You know, it's got to like, burst somewhere.
Someday. And like, it wouldn't burst like in the sense that like, but I'd go on like a roid rage type of like burst. It would just burst like, just in the way that I am, like my behavior. But now that I've been able to like identify that and been able to speak to like Chelsea about it, like now she knows how to talk to, or like how to deal with me when I tell her about it. So like if I tell her, oh, I'm not having a good day today, then at least she knows, okay, he's not having a good day. Like I can't just come in and be like, but why aren't you doing it? Come in
and
hot.
That would be vice versa too.
Vice versa as well. So like that's why I always say like speaking to someone, especially like someone that you feel comfortable with about that stuff, because like I've seen that saying so many times, I'd rather listen to your story than be telling your story.
That's a deep one.
That's a deep one. Like, man, I've lost a few people that I've known to suicide. And one thing that always sticks in my mind is from Ads, believe it or not. He always said this to our boys, is like, if any of you commit suicide, like, I'm not coming to your funeral.
That's like my uncle. My uncle said the same thing.
And
my Uncle Joe.
Yeah.
If any of you commit suicide, don't expect me at your funeral.
Yeah. That's a massive one, eh?
Yeah, hard. That's like, whoa. Like, but and I can see where
they're coming from. Yeah.
That's pretty deep, that I guess that line too.
Yeah, 100%. Like imagine if it's hard to talk about it and this like without being like in it. It's hard to talk about like, you know, that because you don't want to have those thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah.
But just the thought that like, you know, someone that's close to you has said that.
Yeah.
And you know, when you have a funeral, like you want all your loved ones,
yeah,
like all your family and that there, but like, not that you would know, your spirit will probably know, but but just like, you know, I feel like when you hear those words,
yeah,
and then it's just always like, if whenever that thought crosses your mind and then you hear those words, it's just like, oh gee, I better snap out of this,
yeah, hard,
but yeah, I find reaching out, is always good,
yeah.
Especially to people that you're comfortable with, and
yeah,
and that's what. Like, but I won't say my age, but like, and even I'm still learning that at this age, and I wish I had learned like heaps of that stuff like earlier. Mm. But again, like the generation above us didn't, weren't taught that.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's been different.
I'm pretty lucky where. I guess your generation has sort of brought a mental health, but are starting to open up and tell us young boys, you know, that it is all right,
mm.
that there are people here. And yeah, like you said, with your mental health is you like to reach, you know, you reach out and that. And with me, I'm more to myself about it.
Yeah.
And I think that's like shows that everyone's different. And the way they deal with things and and how they go upon their battles and stuff. But that's probably just because I don't ever miss his talk to.
Kill it this. Talk to the head.
But nah, yeah, it is like a pretty serious thing now, mental health. And
yeah.
I was watching a thing, I think it was 50 Cent, he's like where we're from, he said where we're from is a depression is a luxury because you have to get up and go to work and do shit to put, because of those responsibilities that you do have. And I was thinking about it like the other, I think it was like last week, but because my old lady went through a lot of stuff when she was like growing up with us, and hearing that where he said depression is a luxury. I knew my mum, like I seen my mum in some dark places and stuff like that, but she always had to keep getting up and doing what she had to do to provide for us.
Yeah.
Makes me pretty grateful now looking at it, but now that I'm a bit older, you know that those like mental health is real and yeah, it's pretty crazy, like.
But shout that out
whole
to
space around it too.
Shout out to all those people that are doing something about it. Eh?
Yeah, hard. It ain't weak to speak, man.
Yeah,
straight
and
up.
And all those people that are going through, bro. A mental health battle can be as small as like, I don't know, but like, you know, anything to do with yourself mentally is a battle.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So like you said before, like. Everyone has their own battles. Everyone deals with their own battles differently.
Yeah.
Like me and Broads have spoke about how we speak with our, how we deal with ours. So, I think just the main thing is like my way is right for me. Yeah. Broads' way is right for Broads. Like we're not saying that our ways are the only ways.
Or yeah.
Our ways are like our ways will work for you, but like if anything, man, just. Like what Broad said, it ain't weak to speak. Don't be scared to reach out to anyone and always keep in mind, like, you know, what we had said, that little quote. It's I'd rather listen to your story than be telling your story. So, shout out to all those people that are in that that space, either doing it for a day-to-day living or running campaigns and stuff.
Yeah, so.
Well, what do you reckon?
Wrap it up.
Wrap it up from here.
But yeah.
What do we do? We check us out on IG as well, eh?
Yeah, so we just made an IG page, and then I guess you'll be able to listen to these on all platforms.
Yeah, on all platforms.
On all platforms.
Ding. YouTube.
And Spotify, that's about it. But now, obviously, we're coming in with, a new wave, and this is something we wanted to start in.
We better to put ourselves forward.
Yeah, especially putting ourselves out there, so... Now I think we do have someone in mind to be our first guest, but we won't say who, but someone pretty cool, and that's pretty close to us now, so
hard. So I think there'll be a fit, like obviously we're trying to get as many people stories being told. But not only that, like, you know, we'll do some fun things on the side as well. Hard. Hopefully be able to go have some fun and check out some stuff, and we'll try to create as much content as we can, just upload it as well to all our social handles.
We're still working on it, man.
So how does the saying like, follow and share?
Subscribe
to our, you see that little button over there? Yeah, just click it. But thanks for again, like, being able to open up, creating a space that we can create for others, especially those who need the light shining upon their story, to hopefully help or inspire or give the next person, I won't say next generation, I'll say next person, because it's never too old to do anything. Look, we're starting a podcast at they've been around for a little while now, so.
Hard.
But, all good?
Yeah, hard. No, always good to break bread with you. And
hey.
Looking forward to breaking bread with some more people too, and hearing their stories and connecting with them, so.
That's us, man.
Welcome to the Breaking Bread Podcast.
Roll the outro.
We on.
Let's get ready to.
Was it on that beat, hope?